social problems that pop up, that we function as the setting of last resort. We have to deal with all of the outcomes that come from things like public health crises, you know, talk about the opioid epidemic. We talk about the public health issues that lead poisoning causes, everything from, you know, early intervention services that our Human Services Department provides to children and youth, so on and so forth. And while we're the setting of last resort, meaning that we're the last ones to touch the problem, we have to implement the solutions, the human service solutions, we're the setting that's least able to react to it. We can't set the policies that help drive solutions to it. And so we're left holding the basket, so to speak, the bag of the problems and costs. So I think it's incumbent upon us, just as Jim Martin brought forward litigation that would allow, from his perspective and from the county's perspective, the opportunity to address a problem associated with the opioid epidemic. I think it's incumbent upon us to try and do the same when we're dealing with problems associated with lead poisoning, with any type of problem that we can say we don't set the policies that affect the problem that we have, but we have to deal with them. Our citizens have to deal with them. This is by far more activist approach to government than what I've seen. I thank the solicitor and Department of Law, the administration, for bringing this forward. But I'm frankly tired as a county legislator being stuck in a position where we can't effectively and proactively address problems that we face. We have to do it reactively. So yeah, we're talking about litigation, and frankly, I think it's the last reactive thing that we can do for this situation.
Thank you, Commissioner Brace. Anyone else?
Thank you, Val. We appreciate all your help. We really do.
Crisis, whether it be lead paint issues that create a host of problems for human service delivery. You know, we were talking about the Human Services Department on Monday evening and all the services that are provided through that department. Many of the services are in part, not totally, in part necessitated by the presence of lead in our in homes, which, as we've come to learn in our conversations through this process, the biggest contributor to that, and I don't know that there's actually a public policy dispute about this or a legal dispute about this, but the biggest source of that is lead paint in homes, primarily because of aged housing stock. So while we're the setting of last resort, we hold the bag for these problems, we're the last resort in that we have no power to actually do something to prevent these things from becoming community problems. We have to address an opioid problem in our community because policy failures have come about. We can't change laws. We can't go outside of our limited scope of responsibilities to address it, other than to, you know, deal with incarceration, deal with deaths that happen in our community. Funding that was available to them from other settings, federal government, state government. And to some degree, we've had that, our taxpayers have had that available to them, either through the city of Allentown or through the Department of Health, but on a very limited and increasingly diminished basis. Additionally, things like the incentives you described, low interest loans, again, these were all set up through funds that those settings of government had available to them because of that. Lehigh County, as best as I can tell, with the exception of our home remediation program, which the director of DCD and some of his staff gave us an overview of how that program works, we have very few resources available to do what those communities have done, and they're not dedicated sources that those communities have enjoyed because they're direct entitlement communities. If we want to do something, we need resources. We can't just make a low-interest loan program materialize out of thin air. yes, it's a pie in the sky, a long road that we would have if we were successful. Most of us probably wouldn't be on the Board of Commissioners, although Commissioner Dougherty has a track record of bringing that on, and when this is all said and done. I'm willing to put that out now, knowing that 20 years from now, a problem that has been acknowledged by public policy and by the courts as a contributed public health issue with causes that can be clearly identified, I'm willing to make that investment now, knowing that a generation later, there might be public benefit. I have no other answers. I don't think the county has any other answers available. I'm willing to roll the dice. It's a contingency contract if we do approve it after the motion. It's not a personal injury case in the sense that we've discussed with other personal injury cases. You know, I'm at a loss for how we can address the 9,000 some houses in our county and the needs they have, because outside of the city of Allentown, there's no remediation being done. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Brace. Any other commissioner comments?
Here on the board, agreeing that lead is a major problem, and we have seen many studies over the years showing how important it is, especially for children to be in a healthy environment. And as Commissioner Brace mentioned, we do have limited work in this in terms of our Department of Economic Development Office giving out some minor grants for fixing up housing. But we need more money there. But the problem that I have with this is that this is similar to what has been mentioned earlier this evening in terms of the opioid problem. That is something that the county should not have been involved in. This is something that Joshua Shapiro, the state attorney general, should have been pushing, and that's the take that the County Commissioners Association is taking. So the state is not doing its job in the opioid problem. It's not doing its job in terms of lead paint. There should be legislation there and funding that comes down to the county to support the amelioration of these problems. And this is also, we heard about the $5 fee today. This is just another attempt by the state to pass on its responsibilities to the counties. And this often comes as an unfunded mandate in other cases. So this is passing the buck down to us. And I look at this as another attempt there. At least in this case, we are not going to be out any money, but I think I agree with Commissioner Holt. I would like to see a little more time so that we can look at some of the other programs around the country and see what works and what does not work, and possibly come back to the legal question here and maybe hire this particular firm when we see what is happening with the lawsuits in the other counties. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Dougherty. Any other commissioner comments?
My final comment, I've used up everybody's time. We've also filed lawsuits to try and recover 911 fees that we feel we're good. We have obligations to our taxpayers and to our citizens. When somebody is not doing their job, when we have the power to do something, we should do it.
Commissioner Holt.
I would just add that with the 911, we did contemplate that for 2 or 3 years before we moved forward with it. It was certainly not something that we walked into, and this is potentially a 20-year timeline that we're looking at, and so to me, taking another couple months to review this is not a huge ask.
Commissioner Dougherty.
Final comment, this proves my point in terms of saying the state should be leading the charge in all these cases, even the 911, because what we end up with is paying a law firm 33 1/3% of any settlement, plus expenses on top of that. So the amount of money that comes through is greatly reduced. And the amount of money going to people who need this is greatly reduced.
Thank you, Commissioner Dougherty. Last call, Commissioner Common and public input. Public input on the motion.
If I may, David Senoff, the Manipal Voice. Let me just say a couple of brief comments. First of all, taking the last comment first. Yes, there's a contingency fee, but in addition, you'll note that the contract says that in the event that fees are awarded by the court, that those fees would be set off against the county's portion, which means essentially that if we win and the court awards fees, that the county will not be responsible. There has never been any attempt by my firm, myself, or anyone else involved in this project to do this on any other basis than a contingency, because we wouldn't want to further burden the county's resources by charging traditionally by the hour, which would either equate to or eclipse the amount that might ultimately be awarded by the court for fees and costs. Secondly, with regard to the difference between lead paint and the opioid crisis, in 1995, the Pennsylvania General Assembly passed the Pennsylvania Lead Act. In that act, the General Assembly found that lead poisoning and lead paint was a public health hazard constituting a public nuisance. I agree, the state did nothing to help abate that nuisance. However, the county code specifically permits county council and counties of the third class and counties with home rule charters to go ahead and institute legal proceedings, specifically legal proceedings to abate the public nuisances. So the idea that litigation is foreign to abating public nuisance, I think is not the same here as it may have been in other cases. And finally, I'll just say, with regard to California, yes, it took 20 years, but the reason why it took 20 years had more to do with the identification of the defendants, who were going to be the plaintiffs. Ultimately, the referendum that Commissioner Holt spoke about was struck down. The United States Supreme Court did not take that case. The United States Supreme Court has not taken an appeal yet on that case, and one of the defendants has already settled that case in advance of the Supreme Court, the United States Supreme Court's decision in the amount of $60 million. And the Supreme Court, should it take it, will be limited solely to the question of whether or not the verdict that was rendered was simply too high, not whether the case itself should have been properly or improperly brought. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
John Hodges, you mentioned a couple backup things for it. As a contractor going out to, you know, remodel homes or whatever, building work. If I go into some place, I'm not going to remodel and the window put in, I have to test the paint, see if there's any lead problem with it. And then proceed according to all the rules and regulations that are set down by the government. If I do that without all the permits and everything, it's $33,500 a day fine. That's one inspector a year. So that drives all kinds of small business out. It's hard to afford this. You have to be certified to do all this. It's like a hazmat thing. So there's all kinds of costs away. And anytime government puts money into something, prevailing wage. No doubt about it. So now there is no question. That's what happens. There's a dollar of any kind of government money in it, it's prevailing wage cost. So you can't get like the private guys to come in and do the work. We'll do a cheaper, you know. I'm willing to do this. And this is one of my big things. Oh, you must have certified, do all this kind of stuff. Okay. But if I do the work and it's inspected, why should I have to be certified to do it as long as it inspects and passes? So that's another question with all this stuff. You have to have licenses out of the wazoo. This is really tough on small business, really tough. And all these things, I understand there's a problem. I mean, we used to put lead in the gas. You think paint's a problem? That's a big problem. All over the country, the ground's covered with, you know, all kinds of lead. Gasoline, too. And that stuff doesn't go away either. So just a few thoughts on counties or governments getting involved with more regulations. It really burdens small businesses. You can have a big business hire one person because they can afford it, and they sign off on it. They don't have to have people certified to certify. They have one person. But when you're a small business, you wear all the hats, you got to pay for it all. And it is not cheap. You can serve. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Valdez. Last call, public input on the motion. Hearing none.
Mike Grammo, Skin Center Valley. When there's a problem with the structure, and I believe that the primary responsibility for paying for whatever is wrong with that structure is going to be whoever owns it. Rather than trying to gather funds from all the taxpayers of all the state of Pennsylvania and then trying to divvy it out to all these different places, the process of gathering all that money and then distributing it, much of that money is going to be wasted in all the bureaucracy that takes a portion of that money is going to get lost, and every set of hands that passes through is going to have to go all the way up the state and has to filter all the way back down. And people are going to be in charge of distributing those funds, and those people are going to expect to be paid for their labor. And there's going to be all sorts of hidden costs along with that. We see what's happened with the cost of colleges. Way back when, it was far easier to be able to go pay-as-you-go kind of education college. And then the government gets involved. Oh, we're gonna make these student loans, and we're gonna get all these grants, and what's happened to the admission fees and tuition costs at the colleges keeps on going up. If we get involved in this, where we're taking money throughout the state to pay for all these individual homes, it is going to go up. The cost estimates that you have now, throw those in the trash because they're going to go up. And it always does when the government gets involved in it. You know, we consider all the people that are going to have to be involved in this process of distributing all these funds. Every step of the way that those monies get transferred through, there's going to be a loss of money. Every step.
Could you identify yourself for the record, please?
I did. Mike Grimm, Center Valley. Mike Grimm, Center Valley.
Mr. Clerk, can you please take a roll call vote on the motion?
Commissioner Brace?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Dougherty?
No.
Commissioner Grammis?
Yes.
Commissioner Nostein?
No.
Commissioner Hartzell?
Yes.
Commissioner Holt?
No.
Commissioner Osborne?
No.
And Commissioner Zanelli?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I recorded 5 votes in favor and 4 votes opposed.
Motion passes. Write the resolution, Mr. Clerk. Resolution 2018-51, please.
Resolution 2018-51, approving a representation agreement with Anna Full-White.
Madam Associate, will you summarize?
By this resolution, the Board of Commissioners approves a representation agreement with Anna Full-White,
serve as counsel for the county for claims against Sherwin-Williams Company and L Industries, formerly known as National Lead Company. A copy of the proposed agreement and addendum thereto is attached as Exhibit A.
Thank you. Sponsor comments, Commissioner Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just real quick for the public. So with this contract, Annabelle Weiss would assume if they get awarded, again, it's a big if, they're doing the work for no fees at this time for the county, they would get 33 1/3% plus expenses. The whole contract in regard is there's 9,023 homes, 52% are required to get mitigated for lead paint, and at this time, it's about $8,269 to remove the lead paint to mitigate that. Again, these are homes that were built before 1980, just for the record.
Is that all, Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
All right. Thank
Sorry.
You. Thank you. Any other commissioner comments? Any public input? Commissioner Weiss.
On the contract itself, two things. One, under item G, it talks about the county reimbursing the provider for some costs. Could someone explain exactly what that means?
That's relating to the right to know provisions. And that is if there is a matter relating to a right to know request in which there are costs incurred, I believe, by the provider in assisting the county in responding to a right to know request.
So the county's paying the provider for their help in complying with the right to know request, is what this is saying?
If they are required to produce, for example, documents in response to a request that the county does not have control over, we would probably, in accordance with the schedule of the Right to Know Office or the Office of Open Records in Harrisburg, pay them the fees that would be permissible under the statutory structure.
And then, under normal...
This is a normal provision in all our contracts, I believe.
Yes.
Okay. Well, the difference here is that it was my understanding this wasn't going to cost the county, and then I read that the county's reimbursing the provider, which sounds like it is going to actually cost the county something for that little portion of it. I'm not sure I fully understand exactly how that works, because I know right to know requests have been a growing issue here at the county, and the volume and the time, the cost it takes. I would hate to see the county losing out on funds, if you will, because of that.
I'll respond. Upon executing the contract, any document between the county and my law firm would be privileged by attorney-client privilege, which would be outside of the right to know law. So that we would certainly respond to any right to know request that we got, obviously. However, to the extent that the right to know request requested documents that were otherwise privileged documents between, if you think of it as you as an individual having a relationship with an attorney, your attorney doesn't just simply turn over documents. In this case, the attorney could not. We are legally prohibited from turning over documents that fall within the scope of the attorney-client privilege.
Any other commissioner comments?
My second question was, where does it describe in the contract what happens? So let's say there is an award made. Where in the contract does it describe who controls those funds and what happens to those funds?
There's nothing in the contract that discusses that because, quite frankly, we, the attorneys, don't view that as sort of our place. We would certainly ask the court to decide how the funds should be distributed. The court, whoever the judge is, will have to determine how those funds are, what standards are going to be used in order to disperse those funds. It certainly would not be my law firm. We would, you know, certainly provide guidance. We know what's done in other states, for example, in New Jersey. But that would certainly be up to the county once the award was received and paid by the defendant.
That's a question that we asked Director of General Services when the 911 litigation was brought to us. It's something that we would have to decide. Although the Director of General Services at that time made assurances to us related to that question.
Any other commissioner comments? Any public input? Mr. Clerk, would you please call roll call vote for Resolution 2018-51?
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Dockery?
No.
Commissioner Grimes?
Yes.
Commissioner Nostan?
No.
Commissioner Hartson?
Yes.
Commissioner Holt?
No. So I see no reason to recuse myself, but I want the board and the public to know that I'm in that capacity.
Thank you, Commissioner Brace. Any other commissioner comments?